Hello everyone and welcome. In this video we are talking about my S2000 and some dyno numbers. Now first, a big thank you to autotempest.com for sponsoring this video. Nathan, a fellow yellow mellow S2000 owner, he's got a 2006 AP2 Honda S2000, super cool, so thanks to him for sponsoring this video. I'll include that website in the video description. And we're filming in my garage because I have the Honda Civic Type R in for the week as a press car, and I thought it looked cool side by side with the S2000, perhaps a bit better than just staring at me with a whiteboard behind me. So, we're filming in the garage. Now, the topic at hand is how much horsepower does my car make? It's a stock AP1 S2000 2002 with 106,000 miles on it. The only performance upgrade, so to speak, is a rear differential. No performance upgrades to the engine, so bone stock. I just wanted to know how much horsepower does it make, so I took it to a dyno. Now, I thought the question was that simple. It's definitely not that simple. I have not worked with dynos before. This is my first time putting a car on one, and it was a learning experience for sure. Okay, so we ended up doing a total of 4 runs, and I'll put the numbers on the screen so you can see what they are, but basically runs 1 through 3, you can see horsepower remained relatively consistent, the lowest at 181.1, the highest at 183.6, so only about, you know, 1.4% degree of difference there, and not a big deal. Torque, however, ranged quite a bit for the first 3 runs, from 125 to 144 almost, pound feet. And then the fourth run, 221.8 horsepower, 144.4 pound-feet of torque. That wasn't magical tuning, that's literally just some calibration changes with the equipment. So why was there so much variance in the torque number between runs 1 through 3? And really this comes down to the Mustang dyno that we were using to measure power. And so on this dyno, there are dynos where you can just plug in with an OBD2 and read the engine RPM. In this dyno, we're using roll speed to calculate engine RPM. So you're looking at the speed of the actual rolling dyno and then looking at the engine speed and trying to make those two match for the calibration. So in this case, for the first run, it thought that this revved much lower than it does. It's a 9,000 RPM engine, but you know, it maybe had us peaking at around 6,500, 7,000 RPM, something like that. So it thinks the engine isn't revving as high as it is. And so because torque and RPM are inversely proportional, if it thinks the RPM is lower, but it's still getting the same amount of power, then torque is higher. Versus if it knows the engine RPM is much higher, the torque number is going to be lower with the same amount of power. The car is doing the exact same amount of work, which is why you don't see the horsepower number changing. The car is doing the same amount of work, just where it thinks that engine RPM differs. So by the third run, where it's mostly dialed in, it was probably off by about 100 RPM or so for the third run, but not a major deal as far as how much of a difference it's going to make for these numbers. So peak horsepower, 184, peak torque, 125 pound-feet. Now, the fourth run, this is the case where it differs from dyno to dyno. So this was running on a Mustang dyno, which is an electric dyno. A lot of people out there will run theirs on dyno jets, which are inertia-based dynamometers. And basically the difference is that the dyno jet doesn't account for quite as many variables. This Mustang dyno will account for example, the weight of the car, aerodynamic drag, things like that, and build that into a brake on that drum, versus the dyno jet just purely uses inertia to spin up a drum to measure the horsepower. The difference is the dyno jet will read higher versus the Mustang dyno, pretty much across the board. And so what Mustang told this shop, Throttle Works, which I was very grateful, they let me in, check out their shop, and had me out on their dyno, so big thanks to Throttle Works. Mustang told them that if they want to compare directly to dyno jet numbers, basically to put in this parasitic multiplier of 2.2 rather than 1.0. So this is a simple little parameter that you plug in into the dynamometer and tell it, hey, the parasitic multiplier, which is basically saying this is how much horsepower the dyno is using up just to run. The multiplier goes up to a 2.2, and that will make you comparable, so you have comparable readings to a dyno jet dynamometer if you've been using another and then came to this and wanted to know, you know, where are you at. So obviously those numbers are a huge difference, 222 horsepower versus 184 horsepower. I would assume that, you know, realistically, it's probably much closer to the 183.6 because, you know, it's an old car, it's 15 years old, it's gonna have some losses with time. And then also, you know, just 222 horsepower would mean only an 18 horsepower loss from the engine, very low, less than 10% to the wheels. I just don't believe that would be all that possible with a car, especially given its age. So is it 184 horsepower or is it 222 horsepower? Well, honestly, it's probably neither. It's probably somewhere in the middle or perhaps towards that lower end. Either way, the thing that you need to learn from this is that first run of just getting the baseline in isn't all that important. It tells you a number, yes, but it's not a number that's worth going out and showing your buddies and saying, hey, this is how much power I make. Instead, it's a number that you use to see if modifications that you make to the car actually make improvements. So now I can go into that same shop with the same conditions and say, okay, I've changed this on the car, and ideally you would do the changes on the same day and measure it before and after, but you know, realistically, that's not always going to happen. So good enough to at least just go back to the exact same dyno. So you put the car on there again, you put in the same calibration settings, and you see, did we actually make an improvement by putting this on? And so I'm gonna be doing two different tests. I'm gonna be putting on a titanium catback, which I'm super excited about, and also a supercharger, which I'm also very excited about. Yes, it is eventually going to happen. Hopefully it doesn't start snowing too soon here so I can actually get some things done with the car before the weather gets really crappy. It's getting cold though, so you know, I'm gonna have to play with weather and we'll see how it goes. So the question, when is a dyno not useful? And really this is about ego. So if you're going to a dyno and you're deciding, you know what, I wanna find out how much horsepower my car makes, that's probably the wrong reason to go to a dyno, because you could go to 10 different dynos and you're gonna get a different number every single time. If you wanna see how much you're going to improve, then great. You do the modification, you run it before and after, you see exactly how much power you've gained from doing it. Now, when you are testing your vehicle for modifications before and after doing dyno runs, what you wanna look at is the entire curve itself, rather than just the peak number. Is the curve itself, is your entire torque curve lifting up? Or is it only lifting up in certain sections? Things like that. One of the things that's cool to look at on the graph of my S2000 is at 6,000 RPM when the VTEC kicks in, you actually get an increase of about 15 pound-feet of torque. So it's pretty neat to see that in the dyno plot. And it's actually a relatively flat torque curve, you know, going from about 4,000 to 6,000, then it bumps up another about 10 to 15 pound-feet and then stays a bit flat until you start getting well over 8,000 RPM, and then it starts to taper down again. So cool to look at and see, you know, the actual benefits of something like VTEC. You know, simple technology, it's just a higher cam profile, but neat to see in the dyno plot. It's not a number that you can go to your buddies and be like, hey dude, my car makes way more horsepower than yours. It's like, well, if you put them both on the same dyno on the same day with the same settings, then perhaps, yeah, you make more horsepower than your buddy. But if you did them at different shops, it's like basically meaningless. So use it as a tool for learning if your modifications have helped you, for tuning, for things like that. Don't use it as a bragging rights tool, because honestly, that tuner can just go in there, they can, you know, type some stuff into the keyboard with the settings of that dyno, and this car can say that it has 800 horsepower when clearly it doesn't have 800 horsepower. So my goal certainly wasn't to say that dynos are useless. They are very useful, but for specific scenarios, and probably not the one that a lot of people use them for, which is like bragging rights of this is how much horsepower my car makes. So the next steps for me are putting a catback on this, measuring the horsepower again, see if there's any difference, and then slapping on a supercharger and seeing how much horsepower we can gain with that supercharger kit. And again, a huge thank you to AutoTempest.com for sponsoring this video. If you haven't yet checked it out, it's a pretty cool website that compiles a bunch of different listings, local listings for cars that you can find. So of course, we'll just do a quick search basically everywhere for Honda S2000s. My goodness, this 2000 for 22 grand, that's almost double what I paid for mine, which is a 2002, but not many miles on it, 45,000. Let's see. Ooh, there's a yellow one. There's another. Hey, we've got a yellow one in Boise. Pretty cool, 2001, and selling for 18,000. Now, the reason I think you should go 2002 or later is because they start to put the glass window in the back rather than this clear plastic that's kind of crappy and fades and you can't see through. So 2002 and later are the years to buy. Great car, cool website. Thank you all for watching. If you have any questions or comments, feel free to leave them below.